with us. This is Why in the Morning, and my name is Dereva Hilary. Time for health. I'm speaking to one and only Elena Sieku. She's a project manager who turned a philanthropist from Maralal, Samburu County. She has been helping young people and the communities up there. I'm sure you understand what happens in the northeastern parts of Kenya, and this is a community that needs all the help that we can, and we're hoping one day they will catch up with the rest of the society, not in a bad way, but they need help truly. Good morning.
Good morning,
Hilary. Happy to have you here.
Thank you for having me here today.
Now, when looking at your profile, I was wondering what specific thing will I try to cover in this particular segment, but yeah. Seeing you were a mental health activist, you will tell us how the situation has been up there, how you turned to be a philanthropist, being a project manager. Maybe you left your profession and decided to do something else. And in that regard, I'm giving you an opportunity to tell us who you are and then you go from there.
So as you've introduce me accurately, my name is Elena Sieku. I'm a project manager by profession. I left a more engaging 8-to-5 job, and I'm still employed, but on a more flexible job. I still do project management at a software company, and then now I'm a turned philanthropist.
Did you say software company?
Yes.
What exactly do you do?
Well, the company that I'm employed at, we do software development for governments. Yeah, so we work to enable a lot of digitization of the government services. Mm-hmm. So that's what we do.
All right. Yes. Now you decided to help your people. Maybe I could say giving back to the society.
Yeah.
You decided to go back and help your people back
yes.
home. What inspired you?
First of all, I am a daughter of the North. I was born and raised in Maralal, Samburu County. Mm-hmm. I came to Nairobi for university studies, and then I got a job. So I've been in Nairobi for about 10 years. Mm-hmm. So what inspired me is I struggle with mental health myself. Mm-hmm. I had a mental health problem that after diagnosis mm-hmm. became a mental illness, which was trauma, mm-hmm. and I had suicidal thoughts. So upon getting treatment for my mental illness mm-hmm. is when I was inspired to be an activist for mental health, because even myself trying to access healthcare mm-hmm. for my mental illness from my work and then outside was a bit difficult for me. Mm-hmm. So I decided that it's important for people to know about mental illness, and it's important for people to understand what mental illness is, because mm-hmm. there is a difference mm-hmm. explicitly between mental health and right. mental illness. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So then after that, I guess for the past 3 years, because this happened about 3 years ago when I was extremely depressed mm-hmm. and I had suicidal thoughts. Mm-hmm. And then after getting treatment, I decided, let me start reading more about my illness. And then through that, I found out that there's a lot of lack of knowledge in mm-hmm. the general Kenyan public.
Right.
So that particularly materialized to my passion, which is now philanthropy. Then this year I decided that it's important for me to go back to my community
right.
and start doing work there around health and around education.
Right.
Yeah. So it was born out of my personal struggle.
All right. And I kind of want to get your story kidogo.
Yes.
Now, during that period that you are going through the mental problem or the mental health,
yeah.
I should say, how did you discover that you have a problem? Did you go for maybe medication? Did you go for counseling? Because we have many people who do not know they have a problem
yes.
until it escalates.
Yes.
Yeah.
So mine, neza sema ili escalate mm-hmm. totally, because I was employed full time. Mm-hmm. So I started underperforming, and I was a stellar performer. So I started underperforming. Mm-hmm. I started sleeping a lot. I started having no interest in things that I loved doing. All mm-hmm. my hobbies became so tiresome. So I just wanted to sleep. I would cry for hours for no apparent reason. Mm-hmm. And then I remember clearly one of the most profound memories that are stuck with me is I used to come from Mombasa Road mm-hmm. through the Southern Bypass and go to my office. Mm-hmm. Just to be in Kikuyu. Mm-hmm. So the bypass, every time I was driving across the bypass, mm-hmm. I had these suicidal thoughts that mm-hmm. I would probably cause an accident and just die. Maybe all my problems will be gone. Mm-hmm. And then I stayed away from home and from engaging with my family for a period of 6 months. Mm-hmm. So I was always just tired and depressed and drinking a lot. I used to drink so much. Mm-hmm. So, and then because, you know, when you're depressed, you're looking for something to numb you. Okay. So alcohol was it for me. Then I think my uncle is as a psychologist. Mm-hmm. So he used to call me, they used to try and reach out to me and find out what's going on, why are you not talking to us and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. So then I started talking to him and he told me, I think you might be depressed mm-hmm. and I will recommend you to a counselor. Yeah. So, you know, when you have a mental health problem, it's important that you go to a counselor first. Mm-hmm. Then the counselor will try and counsel you through the problem. Tell me what your problem is. Mm-hmm. Let us see why you feel this way. Why do you want to take your life? And then from there, if it is past counseling, then you can be referred to a therapist right. where now you can get medication. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So that's how it became about.
All right. Now, you have gone through this process and you have decided to go back to help your people because yeah. at some point, I'm sure we all undergo through mental problems in different ways.
Yes.
And could be triggered by one or the other thing, but exactly. it is very different from the other person.
Yeah.
Now, how has your reception been up there?
First, it's difficult because you're dealing with people who don't understand what mental health is. Mm-hmm. And even before I went back to my community, right. there is still a problem here in Nairobi. As much as we are advanced with education and knowledgeable, mm-hmm. there is still a lot of stigma surrounding mental health problems. People are mm-hmm. not confident to come out and say, by the way, I'm depressed. Mm-hmm. And especially this particular year of 2020, where we have seen a rise, the pandemic.
Right, true.
So, which has caused a rise in loss of jobs, mm-hmm. in people stopping their education. If you were to clear university or campus this year, mm-hmm. and then all of a sudden the whole year has been locked down, you had mm-hmm. plans for your life.
True.
So, you know, some friends were the people who are anchoring you down. So now you're forced to go back to your culture, maybe mm-hmm. probably you are struggling up in your family.
Yeah.
So those issues just really contribute to poor mental health. So starting even from here in Nairobi, there's been a lack of knowledge around mental health. And I keep insisting, mm-hmm. having poor mental health is not necessarily having a mental health illness. It's not having an illness at all.
Okay.
There's a difference completely. And that's why I always advocate mm-hmm. that it is important for you to go for counseling. Then you find out if you are ill or you're just mm-hmm. having a mental health problem that can be managed.
Right.
And then up north, of course, there is lack of knowledge, there is lack of facilities like accessing social media or accessing digital education. Mm-hmm. So people there don't necessarily understand.
Right.
So there is a lot of work that we're putting mm-hmm. in terms of educating first before we even tell you that this is a mental illness or a lot of the people have been left off to deal with drugs, like, you know, mm-hmm. the common drugs there are miraa.
Because
they're cheap mm-hmm. and you know, illicit alcohol that is cheap. So you see a lot of people are drinking and doing these drugs mm-hmm. but they don't know why they're doing, and yet it is a coping mechanism. So mm-hmm. trying to educate them first mm-hmm. on what mental health is, and then now we come to now giving the solutions
mm-hmm.
because you cannot give a solution to a problem that somebody doesn't understand.
Very true.
Yeah.
Now, in your engagement with these people, now that there's a communication barrier, there's a difference in age of understanding the technology, what programs are you running?
Okay, currently we are running programs to deal with education, mm-hmm. because one of the goals that I have is building sustainable communities. Mm-hmm. And sustainable communities encompasses ensuring that the health sector is okay, mm-hmm. ensuring that people are educated, and ensuring that people have food and shelter. Mm. So first we are trying to educate them on how the programs that we are running are targeting the youth right now. Yeah. Then from the youth are able to educate their parents. Because you see, the other problem that we're facing is cultural barriers. True. Because you understand, these people are not as advanced as we are. Mm-hmm. These people are still holding very strongly to their cultures. Mm. So you cannot come and tell them that no, stop this or stop that. You have first to come, mm-hmm. sit with the community. So the programs that we have is sitting down with the community first, mm-hmm. understanding their greatest need, then formulating mm-hmm. Programs that actually attack or address those particular issues that they have. Mm-hmm. Because to you, they might seem very primitive, but mm-hmm. to them, they are very comfortable. Mm-hmm. So you have to come back and address that. So one of the things that we did quite recently, mm-hmm. in partnership with an organization that is called Naweri Development Child Program, mm-hmm. we are doing, we distributed sanitary towels and educated the girls, mm-hmm. and then also distributed solar kits to vulnerable homes and educated the families on how having at least some form of electricity, mm-hmm. will be able to enable them to continue education. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Now, okay, that could be the bit of the access to education, but I want to speak on this particular matter, because I've heard of people who want to educate or to do public education in the rurals, mm. the reach of the people they will get, mm. it's always difficult because of, yeah. the number, people are busy.
Yeah.
Now up there, how many people do you reach in a day or in a particular program that you are running in a specific day?
Okay, like I will take an example of this project that we just quite finished the other day. Mm-hmm. We target a specific group. So we targeted about 1,162 families. Mm-hmm. So we, and you know, you cannot do this alone.
That's quite a number.
Yes, it's quite a number. And you cannot do this alone. Mm-hmm. Initially, we were targeted 800, and then we got to 1,000, which we are very, very proud, and we are very happy that we were able to do that. Mm-hmm. One of the strategies that I had was, I cannot do this alone. Mm-hmm. I must partner with organizations that are on the ground so that they can help with mobilization. Mm-hmm. So that's why I partnered with Naweri, because they are a local NGO, mm-hmm. covering Isiolo, Samburu, and Marsabit counties. Mm-hmm. So the program we did was across those three counties. Mm-hmm. So we had mobilization done before we went there. I first had to do a trip on my own, mm-hmm. and then identified the needs of the community. Mm-hmm. And the dire needs was addressing the menstruation health first. Mm-hmm. And then after that, now is when we mobilized each town. Mm-hmm. We had a team that mobilized. So in each town, we accessed about 290 people, mm-hmm. In one sitting. So this was just phase one. So we're working now towards phase two, coming in November or December.
All right.
Yeah.
You just mentioned of the menstrual health, and I remember there's a program sometimes back we were running on giving out the sanitary towels to, yeah. some ladies, and I remember stories we used to hear, yeah. about some girls, you're living with your dad and you can't tell them I need this and that.
Yeah.
And it has been a problem even in this country. I have seen our politicians trying to advocate for better, or maybe to a point where they'll be free. Now up there, how is the situation? Do they understand?
We really struggled with first the menstruation, because one thing I want to understand is, mm-hmm. the culture of the people in the north is totally different from what people perceive, right. here. And then also the environmental factors there really, really contribute. And I'll give you an example. One of the towns that we visited up north in Marsabit County, mm-hmm. they're marrying off girls because they're unable to afford menstruation products. Mm-hmm. So for them to cope is a girl, once you start having your menstruation period, you're married off so that you get pregnant and then we don't have to deal with the access. And so what we decided to do to address that is to give girls the education first, and then also give them a year supply. So we distributed about 14,000 sanitary towels to this 1,000 girls. So that means each girl got a full supply, because then you're also looking at how many times do they menstruate. So the average day of a girl, the average time that they have their menstruation period is 3 days, so that the sanitary towels that we left for them would be sufficient for a period even of 8 months, you know. Then of course, as we're going on with the with the program, we'll continue adding for them. The other issue that we faced immensely, where we are now looking at sustainability, is the fact that we're not able, up north there is little access to water. So for you to have, for us to be able to distribute reusable sanitary towels, people need to have water. So if I don't have water and you're giving me reusable sanitary towels, then you're not helping me. Okay.
Clearly.
Then the third problem that we faced is the extreme heat conditions there. So that causes for us to provide these girls with cotton-made sanitary towels. So we're very happy to be working with a company called NIA, Zana Africa. They manufacture cotton sanitary towels, because one of the challenges the girls were telling us is we end up changing our sanitary pads over a period of after 1 hour because of the extreme heat. And most of the products that are manufactured are not safe for high areas that have high heat, because we were looking at 38 degrees of of heat. I mean, you can imagine, you're just sweating profusely. And then the other thing is the parents come from very low income families. They're not able to afford. To you, 50 bob per day, how many 50 bobs do you use? If I assume, do you go eat your mandazi in the morning na chai, you ni kama 30 bob, you go eat your lunch.
In Nairobi, it's expensive.
Exactly. Chapati ndondo, umesema ni 100 bob, you still, you're using your transport. So at the end of the day, you're almost using about 500 shillings per day in Nairobi, let's say, if like you're looking at a middle class level person. But that place, people don't even have access for 50 bob to buy sanitary towels. So those challenges, and even the parents don't understand. I mean, you're marrying off your daughter because you don't want the burden of affording sanitary towels, you know. So it took us a lot of energy to first educate the girls, listen to them, get the feedback, get the data, then now provide them with safe sanitary towels that are fit for their environment.
Right.
Yeah, very fit for their environment. What we're looking at is sustainable communities. We don't want to be philanthropic for the sake of being philanthropic. Then you're damaging the girls more than you're helping them.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah.
Now, you mentioned of the outreach being 1,000.
Yes.
Now, the information that they have get, how impactful has it been in terms of sharing with other people who didn't manage to come to the sessions that you had, or how impactful has your program been?
Well, at the moment, we're not able to monitor the impact until after maybe 2 weeks. But one of the immediate results that we got was the girls went and spoke to their people. The girls went, and the teachers actually were the ones who were telling us that they're very happy, that they even want us to come back and do it in a full 2 hour sessions, because what we were doing was just educating them on five components of menstruation, that is menstruation period and then menstruation health. But now the teachers told us we need to come back and make it a curriculum for them, so that they are more educated each and each time. But then again, the impact that we are looking for is a long-term impact. So it's not something that we've just done once. We'll still go back and target a different number of people, and then go back for phase three and target and ensure by the end of 2021 we are able to reach each and every person that is within the age gap of at least 12 to 20 years old.
Now I want you to take you back to mental health.
Yes.
Having been through the process and then gone to up north and interacting with those young girls, I'm sure you must have met one who was married off at an early age.
Yes.
how did you help them? Maybe they were going through the mental problem. How did you help them, and how was the result?
Okay. One of the let me take it back a bit. To cultural. You see, I cannot come and uproot your culture just like that.
True.
That's why we decided, as a first step, is details gathering process, where we gather the details that are there. So first we see girls experiencing early marriages. We see girls experiencing that early marriages, of course, gives birth to early teenage pregnancies. And then we see the culture of FGM. Very rampant there. So you find a lot of girls are very shy to even speak. It took us a lot of energy to get them to speak out loud. So we were having sessions where we were about 20 people in a sitting, or 40 people. And we would ask them, who wants to talk about this? I know most of you have experienced this. Are you willing to talk? None of them would be willing to talk. So first you have to deal with the stigma. So we are just there, first of all, encouraging them to tell them that we understand FGM happens. We understand that most of you have been married off. We understand that most of you are mothers, even at your young 14, 15 year olds. And we are not here to judge you or to tell you that this is bad. We accept that this is what has happened. And what we are here for is to educate you. So first we try and eliminate the stigma, because they are afraid. They're afraid to speak up. This is their culture. This is what has been happening. So we cannot come and tell them, oh, early childhood marriages is bad. Don't FGM girls, don't do this. No, we come with a place of understanding the culture. And then from understanding the culture, we acknowledge that this has already happened to you. And now how do we help you manage yourself after this has happened? So now we're just having small sessions to, because when we started with the 40 group, we saw that people are afraid to speak. So we went to small 20 group, and then we went to individual conversations. So after the mental mental and menstrual health conversations we had with the group, we would now identify one-on-one sessions where we would sit with the girls, and they would say, this is what I'm feeling, this is how I am going, this is what is happening. Of course, you can't tell that girl, you can't advise that girl, oh no, run away from home. Where are they running to?
It's a very wrong. Thank you so much, and what you're doing is quite great. I'm giving you an opportunity to speak to someone there. Actually, I'm sure you might be needing support from the other sectors of the society. You need help. Final recommendations, it will be your camera. Tell us something.
Well, what I would require is a lot of support, especially in raising funds to buy these menstruation products and also to run the programs that we have. So I would, I think, maybe share a poster with you where you can share on your platforms. And then we are able to all collectively raise funds, because I cannot do it alone. I can only do it by the help of very many, many people out there. So that is what I would like to ask. Just appealing for people to come together and donate and support the fund drive, so that we are able to reach more girls and more families within the North.
All right, thank you so much, Elaine, for coming and trying to tell us how the situation is out there. Many people would never know unless or until they have been told.
That's true.
Is great. Back home, thank you for keeping us company. We'll be taking a very short musical break as we wind up this conversation. Then coming up next is the political segment. It's gonna be fire. Stay tuned to I254. She has been my guest, Elaine Nasieku, project manager and a philanthropist in Maralal, Samburu County. See you in a bit. My name is Dereva Hilary. Good morning.